from rags to riches. If you would.
Hey, this is Donny, Donny T and friends. This evening, I have my great friend, Lenny Clarke. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after this.
I'd be a millionaire.
You know, Lenny, I got to tell you one thing. First of all, this is a great pleasure to have you with me this evening. It likens me back to back in the day, because you and I are probably similar age-wise.
Yep.
Remember the show, Ralph Edwards? Well, this is your life, yeah. Oh, Lenny Clarke.
Yeah, if it was anyone but you, I'd be out of here right
now. I know you would.
This is my life. I don't want to end my life. No.
Well, you know, Lenny is probably the most popular comedian here in Boston area. But what people want to know about you is your life, Lenny, okay? I wanted you to be very comfortable here this evening. Mm-hmm. That's why I brought
home
Vegas
away
to
from
you.
Home.
Yep.
Home away from
You've
home.
Been there a few times.
You know, I've been there upwards of 70 times, I think. You
really,
know? Yeah? Yeah. I mean, I used to be there 2 weeks out of the month when I was in Los Angeles. You know, I worked for Mitzi. She'd fly me in and put me up. We were at the Dunes.
Really?
Which is now, now the Bellagio. But it's changed. Oh, my God, Vegas has changed so much. Yeah. When I went out there, you could stand on your balcony and look, and you could see the desert.
Yeah.
And now you can see homes and buildings all the way to the mountains.
What are they going to do about the water?
That's scary. Oh, I know.
That's scary. Having a son that lives there, I'm telling you, it's really scary about the water. Now, I know that you're a very popular guy, okay? And I know you're kind of humble about that. But you were very popular in high school.
Oh, God, yeah.
Tell them, what were you in high school?
I went to a Catholic grammar school, so I was pretty much kept under wraps. You know, I'd act up, but they wouldn't take any of my funny bits. As a matter of fact, they kept me back a year.
Did they?
And I was I was crushed. And when I got to public high school, it was like, no one's beating me. I don't have to worry about this. You know, and I'm talking about the nuns and the priests. Yeah. I started making friends, and it was really great because I would always, I was in sports, so I was one of the jocks, and I liked women, so I was friendly with all the girls, and I liked the nerds and the kids who would get picked on by the bullies because I wouldn't stand that. I'd defend them, and they would help me cheat on my tests. So it was a really nice
It was a win-win
It was a win-win for me, yeah. And what I did was I made my locker a bar. So say, you know, I had cold beers and ice on the bottom, and I made different racks. There'd be wine for the girls, and there'd be tequila, and there'd be gin and whiskey and all sorts of drinks. And, so you're going to trigonometry? Try a shot of tequila. That'll help you with trigonometry, you know. And these guys, they remembered it, and they all liked it. Yeah. So when I ran for president, I got elected. And then my sophomore year, I had two lockers. And my junior year, I had two lockers, would room into a third one that no one used. So when I finally became the senior class president, that was a big deal.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, it was a big deal the first 3 years. But they came to me and said, Lenny, we've never had a senior class president not go on to college. So I applied to University of Honolulu, Hawaii, Miami, Arizona, all the party schools. And I got rejected from all of them. I wasn't a great student. But then I saw this school, American International College, AIC, almost in college, they called it. And I applied, and as a gag, I said I was black. And I got a full ride. So I went out to Springfield, and my father's going, what have you done? I go, Dad, they, maybe because I'm the president, they want to, you know, keep things going. And I went out there, and the roommate that I was assigned did not. He didn't want to party, and he didn't want you. I came here to learn. I came here to make friends. I said, okay, you know, maybe you should get another room, you know. So he did, and then I had a single. And so I turned it into a bar room. There were stripper poles, everything, couches, TVs. We were doing it right. And that was a full working bar. And actually, I got elected president of my freshman class. And then I came back after freshman year, I got elected president of my sophomore class. And then the black student government wanted to give me a big award. And I knew this wasn't going to work out. So I walked into a conference room, like an auditorium full of black people. And they go, "Who are you?" You know, they thought it was the janitor. I go, "My name's Lenny Clarke." And they go, "D. Lenny Clarke?" I go, "The only one I know." They go, "You've taken money away from a deserving black student." I went, whoa, wait a minute. I'm a deserving white student. Both of my parents are in the hospital. I mean, I come from nothing. I come from the housing projects. I mean, I don't know if you people have picked up on it, but right now the big thing is reverse discrimination. And that was my ace card, because it was on Time and Newsweek that particular week. And they said, "Okay, if you go away, we won't sue." I said, "We'll call it a push." So I left, and I went to UMass Amherst, and I was there for 2 months until they realized I wasn't enrolled, and they gave me the boot. But I eventually graduated from UMass Boston. It took me about 8 or 9 years, but I got through. And I have a bachelor's of science, a political science, in bachelor's of science.
Yeah. Well, I heard you were a Rhodes Scholar, and I asked you about that one time, and you said to me, "No, Donnie. A scholar of the roads."
Yes.
And that is the truth.
Yes. Yeah, I knew everywhere to go and planned every escape. You got to have an escape plan at all times.
Let me ask you a question. You've been in comedy for how many years now?
I'm thinking 47 years, maybe 48.
What made you get into this crazy comedy thing? I did it for 1 year, and every time I went on stage, I was petrified. I had butterflies in my stomach, and you go on, and you look like you don't have a care in the world. And I've seen your show 100 times anyway. How do you do it? I mean, what made you do it?
I'm just like you. I'm nervous before every single time I perform. Every time. No matter, and I tell the young kids, "Look, if you're not nervous, you probably shouldn't be here."
Yeah, really.
Because I take the nervousness and the fear, and I put it into the energy towards the show.
Yeah.
But I was in college at UMass Boston, and we'd sit in the cafeteria, and I'd make fun, you know, make fun of the news or whatever. And people say, "You should be a comedian." I go, "What's a comedian?" I didn't know what a comedian was. They said, "Yeah, well." So we went to George McDonald's house, got a couple of six-packs, went over, we watched a Woody Allen tape. And a lot of people didn't know Woody Allen was a comedian. I had no idea. Yeah. I knew he was a brilliant director and actor. Yeah. But he was a comedian like you wouldn't believe. So I stole one of his routines. I made it mine. I went on stage, got a standing ovation. Everyone left. One little old man came backstage and said, "You know, Mr. Clarke, you're very funny, but you shouldn't steal Woody Allen's material." I said, what are you talking about? Get out of here, screw." And then I knew I was back. So I never took another person's act or a part of his act after that, till this day, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I struggled and I bombed. But I was bombing so bad that people found it hysterical. You know, a lot of times you see a guy doing jokes and it's not working, and you feel bad for him.
Yeah.
I was so bad, people were laughing. And I didn't care if they were laughing with me or at me. They were laughing, so it worked.
Yeah.
And I finally developed an act and started traveling around the country, and it all came together.
Let me ask you a question. I've been in the audience when you've been heckled.
Oh, Jesus.
Tell us what that experience is like.
Okay. When I first started, as I say, I didn't have an act. And if someone would heckle me, I took it as a personal affront because I was so nervous. And I go, "Why are you trying to screw with me, you know?" And I would stop my act and just fire away. Here we go. I'd start hitting you with everything, you know, whatever, your weight, your size, the clothes you had on. I mean, I'd just start ripping you apart. And Don Gavin once said to me, "You could have took that guy out with a 28, a 38, but yet you insisted on using a howitzer, you know, and destroy the guy." You know?
Oh, I've seen people melt.
Oh, yeah. I'd rather them just listen. Let me do what I plan to try and do. Because you know, I don't know if it's going to work anyway. I'm working out on you. But, oh, no, I don't mind. Now, if there were times when I'd say, well, you suck tonight, Lenny, you don't got it. And I go, okay, all right. You know what I mean? I realize it. You know?
Yeah.
But if you listen to me, I'll make you laugh. Because I find myself, I see people, the last thing you want to see when you walk out on stage is a bunch of people like this. You know, make me laugh, joke boy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's, and the body language gives them off. That's why whenever I'm in a performance, whether it be music or a comic, I never cross my arms. I just sit with my hands to welcome it in. No, don't think. There are times when people will not want to laugh. They say, I'm not going to laugh at this guy. I'm not going to. And I know that. And I get. And then when I get them to laugh, I look over and go, I won. I got you to laugh.
Yeah, really.
I made you laugh against your will. How do you feel now?
Yeah.
It's because some people are crazy.
Somebody that was very, very instrumental in starting you off in your career, a guy by the name of Rodney Dangerfield.
Oh, Rodney, I tell you what. I saw Rodney on The Tonight Show when I started watching TV to learn what comedians were and all that. And he'd kill me. He'd come out, bang, bang, bang. Hey, well, you know, and he was just amazing. I said, wow, I'd like to be like him. So, and Jackie Gleason, he was my number one guy I wanted to be like. So, I get to meet Rodney later on, and he was out in L.A., and he was auditioning comedians all across the country for a show on HBO called Nothing Goes Right. So Mike, my brother Mike's my manager, he says, go ask him if he'll take a look at you. And I said, Rodney, can you take a look at me? And he said, kid, you know, I just looked at 1,500 people. I'm tired. I want to go home. And so I walked away, and it was like Mean Joe Green, the commercial where he throws the shirt. He goes, if you can be in New York Monday, I'll take a look at you. I go, really, Mr. Dangerfield? And Mike goes, we'll be there. So we flew home, got a change of clothes, got on the train, took the train down to New York. And halfway down, Mike goes, you know what you're going to do? I said, I have no idea. He goes, you'll be perfect. So we go in, and it was Bill Hicks, Dice Clay, Don Myrera, Carol Leaf, and Barry Sobel. One other guy. He's passed away, too. I can't remember. Robert Schimmel. And so I see Bill Hicks, and it's down to me and him.
Yeah.
So I said, hey, Bill, I'm Lenny. Nice to meet you. May the best man win. Afterwards, we'll have a drink together. He goes, I'm drinking already. I go, bad answer. So I go outside, and I'm so pissed. I punch in a phone booth. This is how long ago it was. They had phone booths. I busted this phone booth. I was pissed. Then I went back in, Rodney goes, who's first? I said, I'll go first, because I was all amped up. So I went on, and I killed the room and made him laugh like hell. He goes, geez, now I got to put you on the show. I go, not my fault. Not my fault. And then we became friends.
Yeah.
And I ended up doing two movies with him. And he was just a dear, dear pal.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, didn't he, to get his health corrected, didn't he go to the Pritikin Center?
Oh, my God.
Tell us that.
I can't believe you brought that up. Rodney was going to do another movie in the studio.
Yeah.
Wanted him to lose weight. You know, they wanted him to get in shape. So he went to the Pritikin Longevity Center in Santa Monica.
Yeah.
So he calls me up and says, hey, kid, you in town? I go, yeah. He goes, good. Go by and get me the biggest pizza you can find. I want every meat in the world on it. I want lob. I want shrimp. I want steak. I want hamburger. I want sausage, Canadian bacon, regular bacon. Load it up. Put it in a suitcase and bring it down. Ask for Jack Roy, because that was his real name. So I get this pizza. Jeez, it was hard to carry. So I go to the place. I said, Jack Roy. Yo, Mr. Dangerfield. Mr. Roy, Lenny Clarke. Send him up. So I get up there. He opens the door, and he's naked. Rodney loved to be naked. That was his thing. He enjoyed being nude. He didn't care what people thought. So I put the suitcase down on the bed. He opens it up, and he starts going to town. And we're talking, and he's eating, and talking, eating. He finishes the whole pizza. He goes, oh, kid, I should have offered you one. And, I mean, that guy was, he was so good to me. You know?
Yeah.
Not only did I do his special, but a couple of years later, he was doing Back to School. And Kinison was in it. And I'd been on the road with Kinison for about 3 months. And Kinison says, come on down, we'll see Rodney. You know, so he says, hey, kid, how you doing? Good to see you. And he says, how'd you like to be in the film? I said, Rodney, could you do me a favor? Could you put my wife in the film other than me? He goes, What are you, crazy? You're going to give your wife a shot in a major motion picture before you? He goes, well, I've been hanging around with Kinison for 3 months. He goes, say no more. The bitch is in the picture. So he puts her in back really? To school. And she's got a big scene with him when Sam's ripping the chair apart. And oh, very funny. Very funny. Yeah.
Now, I know you've rubbed elbows with some of the real biggies. I'm trying to think of his name. Robin Williams.
Oh, Robin. Unbelievable.
Genius.
Yeah, a genius, but more than that, a great, great guy.
Yeah.
I mean, a really great guy. And he was always on, except when he did a lot of blow. Then he became like a statue.
Really?
Whoa, look at that. Yeah, yeah. But he was... He was a great guy. I went up to see him in San Francisco. We were down in L.A., so we took the flight up to San Francisco and saw him at the Holy City Zoo. And the Holy City Zoo was like a dump, you know, but it's the home of Robin and Mike, I forget Mike's last name, but he was great too, and all these other good comics. And he let us go on stage, and he was just fantastic. Yeah. And we became friendly over the years.
Yeah.
And... He came to Lowell Auditorium,
mm-hmm.
and so Mike called him and said, Mike got to be friendly with Robin, too.
Yeah.
And he said, Robin, we'd like to go see you tonight. He goes, how many tickets you need? He goes, I don't know. He said, well, let me give you the whole front row. So he gave him 13 tickets in the front row.
Really?
And I wasn't there, and he did a great show, and then he said, all you guys, come backstage. He said, let's all go out to get dinner. So they went out in a couple of vans. They said he picked up the whole dinner, and he goes, just tell your brother Lenny I'm doing this because he's a prick.
Really?
He's great, yeah. Great, just great. And my brothers and sisters go, I can't believe it, no Robin Williams. This, it was great.
How about, I'll tell you, one of my favorites, Richard Pryor.
Oh, Richard Pryor. I'm in the Comedy Store one night. And I'd see Richard in there all the time, you know. And I was very, 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 I'm shy about it, you know, because I gave him much respect. If Richard Pryor came in, whoever the list, it could be a list of 20 people, you're all gone. He steps up and he does whatever he wants. So one night, you know, and all the, they're all scrambling to get on. Just let me get on 1 second before him, you know, I can do that. But I walked up to him and I said, Richard, I'm up next. You want to go? And he says, no, I need a laugh. I came here to see you. And I went, oh my God. So I went up and I ripped it. I went as far to the edge as I could. And I'm watching him laughing. And when I came off the stage, he goes, I needed that. And I go, I did too.
Yeah, that's great.
You know, oh, yeah. He was wonderful.
Yeah.
Just incredible.
An up-and-coming comic, what would you give them for advice?
Well, you know, I would say, this is going to seem weird coming from me, I'd say work clean. You know, because I worked.
You told me that one night.
Yeah, yeah. It's all because I like you.
I know that.
And I'm trying to help you. Like,
yeah.
I mean, now some of the guys are filthy just to be filthy. And they're big stars. I mean.
Yeah.
But my mother would always say, work clean, work clean, work. And I was opening for Leno. We were doing a Leno and Clarke expedition. And he was letting me open for him up on down the East Coast. And he said, Lenny, have you ever thought about working clean, you know? And we're having dinner, and I said, well, you know, Jay, I mean, I see how strong you are clean. I see how brilliant you are. But to me, at this point, it would feel like selling out. And he said, no, it's not selling out. It's cashing in. And he goes, you know how much money I get for doing these corporate gigs? Thousands, thousands upon thousands. And they don't care what I do as long as I don't drop an F-bomb. I don't swear, and I took his advice, and I started getting corporate gigs.
Yeah.
And then when my show popped, then I was getting the big corporate gigs. And they'd fly you in for $100,000, and you had to do 15 minutes, and they didn't care if you were mildly amusing, as long as you didn't drop the F-bomb or offend one of the women in the show. Could be the CEO's wife, you know.
And you've been at your best behavior this evening.
Well, that's out of respect to you.
Thank you.
And look, people say, how can you, you know, as dirty as you are, how can you be clean? I've learned. I mean, my mother would never come to see me because I was dirty.
Yeah.
And Harvard University was having Henny Youngman at the Sanders Theater. And my mother goes, Henny Youngman? I love Henny Youngman. You know, I'll take my wife, please. I mean,
it was
so
funny.
Oh, it's funny. So he wasn't selling tickets. So the promoter said, what if we put you on the show with him? And I went, Henny Lenny? And I go, yeah. So my mother goes, you're with Henny? I got to see you. And I go, oh, no. I mean, now I got to work clean. You know. So we go to the Sanders Theater, and I introduce my mother to Henny, and she's in heaven. He's so nice, so polite to my mother. And he's real nice to me. And I go on, and my show was okay, but it was one of those shows where I was editing the entire time. And I only had to do 15, 20 minutes. But no swears. And my mother was dead center. Yeah. And she said, and Henny came out and kept Henny killed. You know what I mean? But my mother said, I was proud of you that you didn't swear. And you see, Henny can do it, but it's taken him years. So if you start practicing now to be clean, later on you'll be able to do it.
You know, everybody knows you as a comic, but you're also an actor, quite an actor as well.
Thank you, Don.
What are some of the movies that the listening audience, the viewing audience, may remember that you've done? Something About Mary comes to my mind.
Well, the thing about Something About Mary is when we got that show, I was going to be the cop, and Sweeney was going to be the fireman. Oh. But I was so fat, I couldn't fit my ass through the window. So they made Sweeney the cop, and they ripped up three fireman suits and built it for me. That's how big I was. I was huge. Oh, wow. And that scene is in the Hall of Fame of movies.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it was the first time I got to work for Bobby and Peter Farrelly. And then they called me back again for other movies.
You know, hilarious scene.
Something About Mary, Stuck on You, Me, Myself, and Irene. They were just really good to me. And that led to other films, you know. Yeah. And, I mean, I did some serious work. And I love doing the serious work. People say, well, what do you like, comedy or serious? I said, I really enjoy the serious because people don't expect it of me.
Exactly.
And I like to consider myself an actor. You know, I mean, I've had more failed pilots than the Iraqi Air Force. I mean, I had a hit show, Lenny. It didn't last because of the Gulf War. Then I had a show called the John Larroquette Show, the 100 syndication. We made it to 88, and then they clipped our wings, you know, because they didn't like John. John Larroquette, monster actor.
Yeah.
Incredible. I learned so much from him acting-wise because he did not accept anything less than excellence.
Yeah.
And another guy, believe it or not, Denis Leary, because we're buddies.
You're brothers.
And we screw around all you want. But when that red light goes on, you better be ready, no matter who you are. You know, because he'll flip out. Because he's ready.
Yeah.
He's one of those guys. He never goes up, never makes a mistake, and he writes it. Yeah, he does it.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's a hell of an actor.
Which brings to mind Rescue Me.
Yeah.
You were huge in that. In more ways than one.
Yeah,
probably.
Oh, yeah. But what happened, before we did Rescue Me, we did a little show called The Job. Now, The Job was about New York police detectives. It was on ABC, and all the stories were taken out of the files of the actual NYPD. So we would do, I had to go for audition. So I flew into New York from L.A., and I was prepared, and I did it. And I said, do I get the job? And they said, well, we'll let you know. And I said, no, that's not going to happen today. I said, I know, well, we make this. I got to know now. I want to know right now. Do I get the job, or do I have to kill Stephen Wright? You know, and then they said, they're all out. They said, no, I'm serious, fellas. I want to know. Do I get the job? And they said, Lenny, you have the job. Please leave. And I went, that's all I wanted to hear. So now I get the job. And I shoot that, and playing a New York detective at about 375 pounds. It was one of the happiest days of my life. I loved it. And then, of course, we get canceled.
Yeah.
And Denis, I mean, he's brilliant. They said, we want you to do a show for us. And Denis says, no, that's it. I'm never going to do another network television show again. And they said, well, please. And they offered him everything. He said, no. So then HBO, Showtime, FX, a couple other big independent studios said, we'll give you a show, and we won't handcuff you. We'll let you do what you want. And Denis said, okay, I'll do a show for you under one condition. I said, what's that? No notes. And they went, no notes? We have to give notes. That's what we do. He goes, well, give notes to someone else because I'm not going to do it. So HBO barked a little. Showtime barked a little. FX stood up and said, no notes. We'll give it to you. So we wrote a script. Denis wrote the script. And it was line for line what he wanted. And whether they accepted it or not, it was in the script. Now, Denis may say, okay, maybe that is a little too crazy. We'll cut that out. But I'm reading my script. I'm going, you want me to say this? And he goes, shut up and read. And it was brilliant. It was brilliant.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and that's what made that show so, so real lifelike.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because, everywhere I go in the country, firefighters stop me. They go, that show is just like in the firehouse. I go, that's what we were looking for. You know?
I watched him in Comics Come Home one year. Your brother Mike got me in there.
Yeah.
He was phenomenal. He multifaceted as an entertainer.
Yeah.
He sings.
He dances.
He
sings.
Yeah.
Plays guitar.
Yeah.
Writes.
Exactly.
And, I mean, he convinced me to sing two or three years ago.
Really?
Yeah. I sang Poke Salad Annie, dressed like Elvis. Remember the suit Elvis wore? 50 million Elvis fans can't be
wrong. Yes.
The gold lamé.
Yeah.
I had that made for me by Chris Guazzo, a local designer.
Oh, great.
Fantastic. And then Denis, so the first day of rehearsals, Denis says, okay, let's hear you sing. And I sang, he goes, this might work. I said, what?
Really?
He goes, you've done some work. Because my voice is, I'm the worst singer in the world. But I was acting like I was a singer.
Exactly.
And, with the band backing me up. And it was just.
Most people wouldn't understand that.
Nope. And it was terrific. And he said, that was great. I said, we'll get you to sing another one. Then. I go, no, I'm done.
Yeah, that was it. I'm a one-song singer.
I'm a one-song pony. Yeah, that's it. I can dance, but I can't sing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, folks, that was Donny T and Friends with my special guest and my special friend, Lenny Clarke. We got to get together again.
Okay. Part two.